Welcome to Church on the Beach. the way, the truth, and the life, and I'm a living sacrifice for you. All for you. You're the way, the truth, and the life. I live by faith and not by sight for you. All for you.
Sovereignly you
Bye. exalted high in the train of His throne, filled the temple, and the seraphim circled round Him in the cloud. He was clothed in glory and exalted high, and the train of His robe filled the temple, and the seraphim circled round Him. Again, I saw the Lord seated on His throne. He was clothed in glory and exalted high. In the train of His robe, filled the temple, and the seraphim circled round Him and they cried.
Spiritual food to sow financially. It's in the Bible. I don't have time to teach that. I could teach it all the way from starting with Genesis on. That's not what the subject the Lord wants me on today. But to just give me an opportunity to tithe, that's a tenth of your income, or to sow, that's anything above the tithe, into the final awakening. If you want to do that, there's no pressure for me. Then I'm going to give you some different ways you can do it. You can mail your tithe in or your seed in and just make your checks out or money orders to Daryl McManus Ministries, plural. And you want to do that? We have people that have already started doing that since I've been saying it. Somebody's has already done that. Somebody else has been faithful doing that. 896 Bonita, B-O-N-I-T-A, Street. And that's in Bayou Vista, B-A-Y-O-U, Vista, two words, V-I-S-T-A, Texas, 77563. Did I get that right?
Yes, sir.
77563. All right. You can also do it by PayPal, if you like to do that. If you like to do it that way, CTKC, those four letters, .net and gmail.com. Or there's people that like to do Cash App. And there are people that ask me, what would you rather do? Somebody asked me that recently. I'd rather you do Cash App, but it's okay. If you need to do PayPal or the other way, that's fine. Because I get an immediate notice when it's Cash App. And if you want to use Cash App, then it's final. Everybody say final. Awakening. A-W-A-K-E-N-I-N-G. Final awakening, all lowercase, real easy. There are people, if you want to use a card, if you don't like any of that, we try to make it as available as possible. You can go to our website, real easy. Daryl, D-A-R-R-E-L-L. There's people that spell it D-A-R-Y-L and all this, but mine is D-A-R-R-E-L-L. McManus, M-C-M-A-N-U-S.com, real easy. All right, the title of the message today, and those that are tithing and giving, I thank you, Lord, for rebuking the devourer for their sakes. You're opening the winds of heaven. You're pouring them out a blessing that had room enough to receive it. Thank you for it. All right, the title of the message today is Jesus is Coming. Oh, is he? Oh, I'm telling you. Jesus is coming. The last three times that we've ministered here at Church on the Beach, we're inside today. We just made a judgment call because of the rain earlier. We've ministered on the signs of the times. Everybody say, signs of the times. We did three messages on that. Part one, part signs of the time, then next one was part two, next one was part three. The title of the message today is Jesus is Coming. He is coming. And I know I've got a different mic on today. The other one's in repair. So I'm trying to get this close to my mouth. How's that?
Yeah.
Praise God. It says I'm in Luke chapter 21, starting with verse 25. It says, there will be signs in the sun and moon and stars. Now we've ministered on some of this. I don't have time to go reteach it. You can find it on our YouTube channel. Just Daryl McManus, real easy. You can find it on our Facebook. It's is Daryl McManus. Real easy. There will be signs in the sun and moon and stars and upon the earth. Just think of that. There will be signs in the sun. The sun has been doing all kind of crazy stuff. It emitted so much volume of fire and light that it totally changed the complexion of the first planet in the solar system, Mercury. I mean, I don't know if I'm going to go any more into that. Signs in the sun and moon and stars and upon the earth. There will be distress, trouble. I'm sure there's a whole bunch of people that prophesied what a great year this is going to be. But God already spoke concerning all that. This is what God is saying. There will be distress, trouble, and anguish of nations. In bewilderment and perplexity without resources. That's where we're at. There's nobody that knows what to do to fix all these problems on the earth. That's why the Antichrist, and that's after the body of Christ, not the body, but the bride. See, the bride of Christ has made herself ready. Most people that say they're Christian, they're living in sin. They're still spouting out F words and God's name in vain and all that. You don't know him. You don't know him. You don't know him. I hang out with him every morning and you don't know him. You know some kind of spirit, some demon spirit you're hanging out with, but you don't know him. He's altogether lovely. He's beautiful. He's wonderful. And so, trouble and anguish of nations and bewilderment and perplexity without resources, left wanting, embarrassed, in doubt, not knowing which way to turn at the roaring, the echo of the tossing of the sea. The Lord spoke to me this morning. There's going to be great tragedy coming. Just shortly, through the sea, through the oceans, to a number of nations. Great tragedy. Verse 26, I'm in the Amplified Classic, whatever you're reading, it's okay. Men swooning away and expiring with fear. One translation says, men's hearts failing them for fear. That's not a heart attack. A heart attack happens when you have arteries and things blocked. And then it causes a heart attack. Can't pump, the blood can't flow to where it needs to flow. See? But a cardiac arrest, that's what Jesus is spoke of here. A cardiac arrest means somebody's heart, there's no reason for it to stop. But it just stops. We're going to see so many cardiac arrests. They're already happening already. Their heart just stops. Why? For fear of what's coming on the earth. Men swooning away and expiring with fear and dread and apprehension of expectation of the things that are coming on the world. For the very powers of the heavens will be shaken and caused to totter. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with great transcendent and overwhelming power and all his kingdom, glory, majesty, and splendor. Now when these things begin to occur. Oh, we're far past the beginning. Look up. Everybody say, look up.
Look up.
And lift up your heads. Because your redemption, deliverance is drawing near. That means the coming of Jesus is so close. Lord, I have nothing to say. I don't. I've preached thousands and thousands and thousands and probably tens of thousands of sermons in my life. And I really don't have anything to say today unless you tell me and show me. And I don't have anything to do because you're already here. The worship was powerful. Your presence is here. I don't have nothing to do unless you show me. I don't have nothing to say unless you tell me. I didn't come with any notes. They always change anyway. So, those of you that have your Bibles, if you would turn to 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians is right after Colossians. Colossians is right after Ephesians. You need to know the books of the Bible, the order. All right, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and I'm reading right now the Amplified Classic. I've got a parallel Bible right now, the New King James Version Amplified, but it's Amplified Classic. So there's a big difference between the Amplified Bible and Amplified Classic. How do you know it's Amplified Classic? Because the copyright will be before the year 2015. If it's the year 2015, you've got some, I don't know what you call it. Anyway, it's another version. All right? All right, I'm starting in verse 4. It says, furthermore, brethren, we beg and admonish you in virtue of our union with the Lord Jesus, that you follow the instructions to walk so as to please and gratify God. That's what we're to do. Every day. When your eyes open, your number one goal is ought to be to please and satisfy God. Not your belly. Not go stuff your belly with donuts and everything else and then go try to pray. You're going to have problems. Because your belly is in charge. Please and gratify God. If you want to do that after your time with the Lord, that's fine. But if you stuff it before you're trying to pray, then you've just got your belly full and your spirit is empty. It'll be hard to try to get in the spiritual realm. Admonish you in virtue of our union with the Lord Jesus that you follow the instructions which you learned from us about how you ought to walk so as to please and gratify God, as indeed you are doing, which this church evidently was doing. Most of the churches were in error. And that you do so even more and more abundantly, attaining yet greater perfection in living this life. Verse 2, and you know what charges and precepts we gave you on the authority and by the inspiration of the Lord Jesus Christ. For this is the will of God. You want to know what God's will is? Here's part of it right now. There's so much in the Bible that tells you what His will is. There are people that want to know specific city, what if I'm supposed to marry a certain person, all that. You need to find out what His written will is first. Start doing that. then God will start speaking to you about those things. For this is the will of God, that you should be consecrated, separated, and set apart for pure and holy living, that you should abstain and shrink from all sexual vice, all of it, fornication, adultery, changing your sex organs. Who would have thought that we're living in a generation people are not happy with? You know why people aren't happy with it? Because they don't know who they are. Right. You can't know you who you are until you know the one that created you.
Right.
You can change it to this sex and then change it back to that sex. And you have so many surgeries, you're going to be in a mess. That's not going to cause you to find peace. Peace is only going to come from God, the one that created you, my friend. It is good preaching. And the Holy Spirit's doing it.
Yes.
For this is the will of God, that you should be consecrated, separated, and set apart for pure and holy living, that you should abstain and shrink from all sexual vice, that each one of you should know how to possess, control, manage his own body. Do you know how to possess and control and manage your own body? That'll tell you where you are with the Lord. If your body tells you, go hit him. Most people go hit him. That person don't even, they have no clue about what life is in this short period of time. Bible calls it a vapor. Like an old steam kettle, vapor goes up. I don't care if you live to be 135 years old. It's like a little vapor coming out of the steam kettle, and then it disappears compared to eternity. Well, I want to go kill myself. The moment you do that, your choices end forever. Because the only thing that's after this life is heaven or hell. That's it. And you won't be able to choose ever again. You'll never be able to make a choice to go get up, get breakfast. Your choices forever will be gone. Just think of that. That each of you should know how to possess, control, manage his own body, not somebody else's body. Well, I'm going to tell you, this is what you need to do. No, that's not what, that's what the person pointing at you needs to do.
Yep.
That person is miserable themselves. So they're going and trying to disturb somebody else's life. That each one of you know how to possess, control, manage his own body. I got a full time, I'm 65, and I've got a full-time job with Daryl McManus. Every morning when I get up, and the Lord had me up early this morning. And it wasn't an easy morning. Normally I'm able to press into the presence of God quickly. I had a struggle this morning. I'm just being real with you. I had to keep pressing and pressing and pressing. And finally, the glory of God came. See, you've got to be determined. The woman with the issue of blood was determined to get to Jesus. She had to crawl through thousands, multitudes of people's feet. How do we know that? Because she touched the hem of his garment. She didn't have an invitation from Jesus. She She knew he was there and that he had the power to heal her. And she said with her own mouth, she kept saying it, the Amplified Classic, if I could just touch his clothes, I will be whole. Why? Because the anointing was on him. Where are you going to church? Are you going somewhere where the power of God is so strong in that minister that if you touch that minister's clothes in faith, that that power would make you well? If not, you're going to a dead church. Get out of there. You better find somewhere where God's moving. I don't care if you use my name. You can say, Daryl McManus said, get out of there. Yes, I said it. Because I don't want you to go to hell. That each one of you should know how to possess, control, manage his own body in consecration, purity, separated from those profane, and honor. Not to be used in the passion of lust like the heathen. That's what the heathen do. They just go jump in bed with anybody. And then the next night with somebody else. You know the quickest way to get demons? And I don't have my board in the back of me. But if I did, I'd draw it all out. I'd have it drawn out. The Lord didn't tell me about any of this at a time. The quickest way to get demons is to go have sexual intercourse with somebody outside of marriage. The moment you do that, you become one with them. That means all of the demons, and if they had sex with 500 people, all of the demons from those 500 people come in you just one time with that person. You got all of those demons, and there's no fasting or praying that can stop it because you became one with that person. Think about it. The two shall become one flesh. That's the act of marriage. It's becoming one. And if you hadn't had all those demons broke off of you, that may be some of the problems you're having. That wasn't me that just spoke. That's a breath, that's an air freshener behind me. If you heard that. We don't edit. Amen. This is real and it's live. Amen. That each one of you should know how to possess, control, manage his own body. You should be able to control your own body. If your body don't want to get up to pray, you make it get up. Most every day my body doesn't want to do it. I have to make my body. My body wants to just lay there. There are times I feel like the Lord wants, I'm just being honest with you, to get up. And I try to go back to sleep. Put the breathing machine and stuff back on, and there's no sleep. Finally, I have to say, Lord, forgive me. I've said this a number of times. Lord, forgive me for laying in bed sleeping too long. And then finally, I start quoting scripture and all the stuff that all the scriptures I quote out loud to him and everything. And then I make my body get out of the bed and start moving toward my secret place. See, do whatever I need to do to get in there. Because that's where my help is. Yes, the Father seeth in secret and rewards you openly. That each of you should know how to possess, control, manage his own body in consecration, purity, separated from things profane and honor. Not to be used in the passion of lust like the heathen, who are ignorant of the true God and have no knowledge of his will, that no man transgress and overreach his brother and defraud him. We got all kind of mess in the body of Christ. One person wants to go, oh, this person's in the church and they've got a business. I'm going to go help them. But then the person in the business doesn't treat them right. They don't fix everything in their car. Yeah, we got a mess on the earth right now. Only Jesus is going to sort it out. Your brother or sister comes to you and you've got a business and you perform a service. If anything, you need to do better for them than you do for anybody. And if anything, give them a discount because they're your brother and sister in Christ. Instead of the cahoots, this is the Holy Spirit speaking. You're in cahoots with the mafia. And they're paying you under the table. This is not Daryl. This is the Holy Spirit. And so you give them discounts. And you're defrauding your brother and sister. You will stand before the Lord one day, my friend. You need to repent and make it right. Wow, Lord, I knew that was coming. And no one transgress and overreach his brother and defraud him in this matter or defraud him in business. There's a lot of people that need to take your bumper sticker off your vehicle. You don't know Jesus. Hawk, if you know Jesus, then they just cut you off. Get that sticker off. You don't know him. For the Lord is an avenger. Do you know that the Lord is an avenger? In all these things. As we have already warned you solemnly and told you plainly. For God did not call us to impurity, but to consecration, to dedicate ourselves to the most thorough purity. Therefore, whoever disregards, sets aside, and rejects this, disregards not God, not man, but God. If you just discount this and go on, then you'll find yourself fighting against God, not me. Whose very spirit, whom he gives to you, is holy, chaste, pure. But concerning brotherly love, and this is going totally different than I thought it would. Brotherly love, for all other Christians, you have no need to have anyone write you, but you yourselves have been personally taught by God to love one another. And indeed, you already are extending and displaying your love to all the brethren throughout Macedonia. But we beseech and earnestly exhort you, brethren, that you excel in this matter more and more. Excel in what? Loving your brothers and sisters in Christ. To make it your ambition and definitely endeavor to live quietly and peacefully. You can't get on the highway. We live in Bayou Vista, Texas. You just get on a highway and most people are not living quietly and peacefully. There are people that try to make their vehicle as loud as it can be. And a lot of them don't even have power. They just want to be seen and heard. My wife Cindy tells me that. She'll tell me, because she used to manage a dealership where they had Porsches and Mercedes and Jaguars and other vehicles. And she could tell immediately, they have no power. And yet they're so loud that people can't hardly take it, but they don't have any power to go with it. They're wimps. Wannabes. Oh my, I didn't know I was going to say that. To make it your ambition and definitely endeavor to live quietly and peacefully. That's what we're supposed to do. When we, you know what a peacemaker is? It took me a long time to understand that. And the Lord spoke to me one day. Son, a peacemaker means that I'm sending you somewhere where there's no peace. Because you have to make the peace. Amen. That's what a peacemaker is. God sends you into a horrible situation for you to make the peace. Oh. And definitely endeavor to live quietly and peacefully, to mind your own affairs. Stop meddling in everybody's business. And to work with your hands as we charge you. In other words, do something in life. Don't just lay around. Verse 12, so that you may bear yourselves becomingly and be correct and honorable and command the respect of the outside world. Being dependent on nobody, self-supporting and having need of nothing. Verse 13, now also we would not have you ignorant, brethren, that those who fall asleep in death, that you not grieve for them, as the rest do, who have no hope beyond the grave. For since we believe, I'm in verse 14 now, for since we believe that Jesus Christ died and rose again, even so God will also bring with him through Jesus those who have fallen asleep in death. For this we declare to you by the Lord's own word, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall in no way precede into his presence or have any advantage at all over those who have previously fallen asleep in him in death. For the Lord himself would descend from heaven with a loud cry of summons, with a shout of an archangel, and with the blast of the trumpet of God, and those who have departed this life in Christ will rise first. Then we, the living ones who remain on the earth, shall simultaneously be caught up to, along with the resurrected dead, in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so always, through the eternity of the eternities, we shall be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort and encourage one another with these words. So the message today is Jesus is coming. Are you ready to meet him? There's the parable of the 10 virgins, and I'm not to turn there right now, but the parable of the 10 virgins is there were 5 that were wise and 5 that were foolish. Y'all can go ahead and come up and get ready. And those that were wise, they brought oil. In other words, they brought the Holy Spirit with them. They brought the anointing. And the 5 foolish, those 10 virgins, they all tried to trim their lamps. And then the 5 that were foolish ran out of oil. Oil represents the Holy Spirit. The 5 that were wise, They had oil. They didn't spend their life on foolish things. They had a walk with God. They had a secret place. They stayed full of the Holy Spirit. They stayed full of the oil. Those five foolish asked the wise, give us some of your oil. They said, no, you're going to have to go buy your own oil. And see, when they went out to buy their own oil, the cry came out at the midnight hour. When is Jesus coming? At the midnight hour. Those that were wise had their oil and their lamps trimmed, and the bridegroom came. That's Jesus. He came at the midnight hour, and the door was open, and they went with him. Later, the five foolish came. They were crying out, knocking on the door. And the Lord said, I don't know you. What words to hear from the Lord is that he doesn't know you. So the message today is, what have you done with Jesus? We've been ministering on all the signs of the times, but I want to tell you, these signs of the times and the judgments that have already started are going to happen, and they'll be quick. And then there will be a final awakening, which will be quick. And after that, Jesus is coming on the clouds to catch you away. The bride. Well, I'm in the body of Christ. Are you in the bride? Are you a bride? Or have you made yourself ready? Have you cleansed yourself from all of your sins? Has his blood been applied fresh to your life? And are you full of the Holy Spirit, the oil, right now? Or are you ready to meet him? Are you looking for him? Or have you still got one foot in the world? I want to tell you what, my friend. He's not coming back for that person. That person will be here during the Great Tribulation. And it will cost them their life to go to heaven. Why would you want it to cost your life because you refuse the mark of the beast from the Antichrist and lose your head? Yeah, they just chop it off. They're doing that already. In all different places of the earth. If you're a Christian, boom, your head's gone. Why won't you come to him now? Jesus is coming. It's the midnight hour. Listen to this as they sing.
Mighty rushing wind.
Important question in the universe is this: what have you done with Jesus? Is he some fictional character? Oh, was he a nice man? Was he somebody that lived? Or are you using his name in vain as a byword, as a cuss word? Why would you do that for somebody that you don't even know? Why would you put damnation behind God's name when you don't know the one whom you're damning? There's coming a time not very far away when the Father, he's going to reach over and touch his son on the shoulder and say, "Jesus, go get my family and bring them home to me." It's going to be at the midnight hour. Will you be ready? I'm going to lead a prayer right now. And if you're not ready to meet Jesus, I want you to pray this prayer with me, because it'll change your life forever. Everyone here also helping me. Oh God,
I realize
without Jesus,
I'm lost.
Without Jesus, I'm going to spend eternity in the lake of fire with
Satan,
with the Antichrist, with the false prophet,
Hitler,
and all the wicked people of the earth. But oh God, today, I repent of my sin. I turn away from it. Jesus, I make you the Lord of my life. I say it with my mouth. Jesus, you're my Lord. I believe with my heart, not my head, that God raised you from the dead. Therefore, I'm saved. Praise God, I'm saved. Praise God, I'm saved. Now let's give the Lord a shout of praise.
Hallelujah.
Give him a shout of praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Amen. You need to get in a good Bible-believing church. And if you don't have one, we'll be here at 10 a.m. on Sunday mornings. Till next time, God bless you.